Welcome back. The market is off a little bit, not very much activity at all. 8 points lower, 85.60. Let's look at the mid-cap index. I mean, that's where the real action has been. The mid-cap index has done 6% in the last six trading sessions now. So the move has been pretty strong. It's still higher. Nifty Junior is flat. Small cap index is also slightly higher, but in the green, that's the point. 46.46, that's the advanced decline on the BSE 500. Nischal Maheshwari is co-head institutional equities and head of research with Edelweiss Securities. Nischal, good morning. Good to have you with us here. Thanks very much. You know, the earnings are 2 weeks now. Last week and this week so far have actually turned a corner. Numbers that we get, which were disappointing earlier, now routinely surprise, especially on the margin side. Do you have an overall way of looking at these numbers? I mean, is it because we're getting more consumer companies now and hence there is a bit of a beat? Otherwise, overall aggregate level earnings are still disappointing?
So, Prashant, when we started this quarterly earnings, I don't think so there was much reason to believe that the margins are not going to go up. Margins were expected to go up given that the you have commodities across the world coming down. So whether it is agri commodities or the industrial commodities, both the sides, the commodity prices are coming down quite a bit. And I think the benefit, first full quarter benefit is was the last quarter of the commodity prices. So margins are expected to go up. The question mark was basically about the top line, and that you don't see very, very strong evidence as yet that the top lines are going up, the demand is back in the economy. That is, I think, still the jury is out on that.
So volume growth is also there. Pricing isn't quite strong. Margins are pretty high for companies. I mean, you know, GSK Consumer yesterday, Marico yesterday, you can look at other Siemens across industries as well in a way, but mostly concentrated in that broad consumer basket. What does it tell us in terms of earnings?
So I told you earlier, basically, so the earnings may be higher than what we were expecting, and that is largely because of the raw material coming down. But has the top line actually started kicking in? Because that is where the leverage plays out. And when the leverage plays out, basically, you will have a disproportionate amount of profits coming in, basically, just because the top line goes up, because the fixed costs are fixed. So that's where we are still awaiting. We are as yet not seeing strong strong signs of demand revival. I cannot say with very strong confidence that we are seeing a strong demand revival as yet.
But unitary volume growth year on year for a lot of companies hasn't been bad, right, Nishit? I mean, that is basically an indicator of demand, right?
So, two-wheelers have been negative. Cars, yes, it has been positive. CV, because of the last favorable previous quarter, you have got a 40%, 20-25% jump. So, it is more to do with that the last year was very bad, and that's why you are seeing the unit volumes going up. But has it come to the levels basically which are a normalized level of growth? I don't see that happening as yet.
Yeah. I mean, there is opposite happening as well. Bata, for example, revenue growth has been some 10%. So there is some volume growth, but there has been pressure on margins. So all kinds of things there going on. But does this, what implication does do these earnings have? And let's stick to the broad consumer space for now. Have from an investment valuation perspective?
So valuations have not come off significantly, basically, even though I think the earnings growth is not as strong. The valuation still remains to be elevated for most of the consumer companies. But given that the visibility on earnings is not very strong for other sectors, I think people are still preferring to stay on with the consumer sector.
Will this lead to any change in earnings estimates, etc.? Because I think the when we last chatted, you were saying that don't expect the multiples to move up, right? It's earnings have to move up. Only then will you see stocks appreciating.
We continue to maintain around 11 to 12% kind of a growth will happen in the earnings for the current year. I do not see any strong signs to go and change my views there, basically saying that 11-12% can be a 14-15% kind of a number. There is no signs of that as yet.
Okay. If you look at the capital goods segment, and I'm just using Siemens, which reported numbers yesterday as an example, Nischal. Across the board, new orders have gone down, but the companies are using whatever operational leverage they have to improve efficiency and improve margins. We saw that with Siemens as well. These are not cheap stocks, right? Especially the MNC stocks there are not cheap. Now, neither are the domestic ones, but the MNC stocks are in a different league. What's your view there, given the numbers we've seen?
The same thing, basically. I think this year, given that the raw material costs are down, that's why you're seeing this kind of run-up, basically. But typically, in a capital goods stock, basically, you shouldn't be looking at a quarter-to-quarter number. It's more to look on a year-to-year number, because quarterly you may have booked one particular order in the particular quarter and your margins may have gone up. But I think it's a better way to look at on a year-to-year basis on Siemens. And I agree with you that the MNC stock continue to remain very, very costly. And we continue to believe that at least on the FMCG side, you can still hold because the earnings visibility is much stronger. But on the capital goods side, I think they are all clearly a sell.
Right. Okay. Do you expect any additional allocation to consumer type of companies from capital goods, infrastructure type of companies?
No, I don't think so, basically. It should be in the reverse has been happening for some time, and I think that will continue. The people keep on moving away as visibility on the banking sector, the infrastructure sector, the capital goods sector, basically, that keeps on improving. I believe money will keep on moving towards the other side.
Okay. All right. Nischal, if I can request you to stay with us, I have to take a very quick commercial break. We'll be right back with you. Take that break. We're coming back. Welcome back. You're with us here on Opening Fire. You've got the market, which is not doing very much. And I think it makes sense to just take a quick look at the top losers very quickly. We were looking at the top gainers. It was all IT and pharma and IT actually, in the top five. Let's look at the losers now. ITC is down 1.7. Tech Mahindra is down about 1.14. Tata Steel is down about 1%. And there is, losses seem to have moderated a little bit. ICICI Bank is down 3/4. Wipro is down 3/4. Coal India is down about 0.6% as well. 435.5 is where Coal India is trading at this point. Let's look at the Coal India stock. We've got the July coal import numbers coming in, and imports are down about 11%. India usually imports about 30% of its requirement, requirement. In July, coal imports have gone down 11% year on year. It's the first drop in more than a year. The natural question is, does this raise some risk for Coal India? Coal India's business per se, demand has been weak. Power demand is very weak. Non-power demand is actually even weak. Even weaker. So I think they could be, as if demand, basically power demand needs to pick up. Demand for coal needs to pick up, both from power and non-power. If that happens, then imports going down would actually be an opportunity for Coal India to substitute those imports. We'll need to see how it pans out, but you know, it'll be interesting to see what happens. I spoke with Anil Swaroop, the coal secretary, a couple of weeks back, and we'll request him to join us again on this data, which we are getting this morning. But I think it's significant. We discussed the coal import issue as well when Mr. Swaroop was with us the last time. And I think we can get some more perspective from him on this and generally the situation with the coal demand. So that's where things stand on Coal India. The stock's been doing very well. It's responded a little late, but very forcefully to the government's very stated attempts and stated and sort of spoken out aloud numbers in terms of coal production targets and things like that. So there is that strong government push tailwind for Coal India, and the stock has been trading at new highs essentially. You know, the market gets a little better. Coal India is one of the names which starts to move once again. Market's down is down a little bit this morning. 436 or so is where the name is at this stage. Nestle is down about 5% now, so it's basically giving back almost all of what it gained yesterday. You know, the news yesterday was that an FSSAI, the food regulator approved laboratory, has okayed one of the Maggi samples sent to it for testing. The Goa FDA had apparently sent the sample to the food regulator approved lab, and the lab had said that, well, no problem, nothing wrong with this. I was saying yesterday that even if this is true, this would just be one sample. So it doesn't really mean that, you know, FSSAI, the case gets weaker in any sense. And this morning, there are actually yesterday evening reports came in, and the FSSAI was saying that the food regulator was saying that, you know, the product was not tested for the levels of MSG in the noodles. So it's not all clear from the lab. So that's where things stand on Nestle right now. 64.89 or so is where the stock is at this stage. Let's look at the PSU bank space very quickly. And let's start with the larger ones, the three large ones, PNB, BOB, SBI. And we can look at some of the others, Bank of India, OBC, Syndicate, etc. So all of them actually were lower. Now they're all higher. This is about 10, 15 minutes back. Most of these stocks were in the red, about 0.5%, 1%, 1.5%. They're all starting to pull back up once again. Not all, I mean, just, some of the names are still lower, but off the day's low, and some actually now in the green. So that's the banking index. The PSU bank index, 0.5%, the bank Nifty, which of course has got a lot of private names as well, is flat, 0.09% lower, bank Nifty that is. Nischal Maheshwari has been with us and he's patiently waiting by. Nischal, apologies for that delay. We're trying to fix audio apparently. I hope you can hear me clearly. Can you?
I can hear you clearly. I'm not talking about you.
Okay, I can also hear you clearly, but I think that our viewers were not able to hear us clearly, apparently. Anyway, thanks for waiting. Nischal, I just want to ask you, get your thoughts on public sector banks. You know, equity diversified portfolios, PSU banks were underowned. If you had a financial services fund, you'd own, I mean, that fund would naturally own PSU banks, no problem. But do you think with this government push, four-year recap plan, etc., that will get corrected, under ownership will get corrected, institutional under ownership that is?
I think so, basically, because there is evidence that the so two or three things basically which the market was actually worried about. One was the asset quality. So I think after this 525 rule has come in, basically a lot of the things are getting corrected out there, especially on the infrastructure front. So asset quality seems to be bottoming out. So I think that is a positive sign. The second thing is, if you get the growth capital coming from the government, which is the largest shareholder in all these PSU banks, then definitely growth is also coming back. The third is some of the CEOs and MDs basically coming in from outside. That will bring in new blood basically into all these banks. So I think these are positive times and the valuations are favorable. So I think it's a good time to actually look at some of these stocks and accumulate them.
You know, even for viewers, right, I mean, who want to do it themselves and not buy a financial services fund or a diversified mutual fund, what would you say? Buy a bunch of them? That's one. Or buy one or two? or buy and two, yeah. Buy the top names or buy the weakest names?
No, I would recommend them to be basically in the top names only, and only buying one or two should matter, because not all of these banks are going to be coming out of the problem unscathed. So we like SBI, Bank of Baroda and Union Bank in that order. So these are our top three picks basically.
Okay, when you said the smaller ones may not come out of the problem, what did you mean? They'd be
unscathed.
They'd be allowed to fail, or basically. That's unlikely. So, they'd be merged, yeah, etc. That kind of activity.
Pardon me.
No, are you saying that the smaller ones would be forced to merge with larger ones? That kind of activity should be expected.
Doesn't seem to be, because the government is right now saying that they will hold on to at least 7.5% capital basically for most of these banks. So I don't see that the government is looking to merge them just because these banks do not have a very strong balance sheet. So they want to rather actually get the problem out of the system before if and when they finally merge it.
Okay, so you like SBI, BOB, Union Bank of India in that particular order. Fair enough. So now, should one, the quarterly numbers used to lead to a fair bit of volatility and meaningful moves for a while. Now that we've got this government plan to recap banks and that tailwind there, would quarterly earnings and, the asset quality, quarter on quarter, that kind of tracking be of any lesser importance in that sense?
No, I don't think so, actually. It has to be there. You have to be very, very particular about, because as I was saying, it seems to be bottoming out the asset quality. But I think what has come afresh in the last one or two quarters is the steel industry, which is facing fresh problems because of the world commodity and steel prices coming down. So I think that particular industry is under a lot of stress. So we have to continuously understand basically where are we headed in this game.
Sure. What's your view on steel stocks, Nischal? Again, big beaten down space. Any sense in owning any of these names?
No, I don't think so. It is best to be avoided actually. At the moment, there is value, but I don't see that it may just remain there to be. So it could be a value trap actually.
Can the government do anything? Government come to the rescue? There was reports of 30-40% safeguard import duty for HR products. Or you think that will only be temporary?
That's the only thing government can do. That's the only thing can the government can do until unless the demand revives. So I think, but then it makes inefficient players also survive in the system. And second thing happens is basically it makes steel costly for the whole country. So yes, it will be good for the industry, but then the whole country suffers. So custom duties are not a very good thing to put on.
Okay, fair enough. Any thoughts on Sun TV, Nischal? The big move we've seen, it seems that there seems to be an opinion that not only will the issue with the government get resolved, but there seems to be some chasing after the Z multiples as well. I mean, assigning, otherwise the stock actually got to almost about 390 or so, right? It fell from 350 in the first instance. It went way past that level. Any thoughts at all?
See, it's a stock where there has been huge amount of volatility, and not from last 1 year, but if you go back into history, it has always been very, very volatile actually. So I think in a space which is a fairly secular space basically, why to hold anything or why to own anything basically which is such a volatile stock. So I think it is best avoided.
Tata Motors will come out with earnings tomorrow, and we'll hear from the first time from the management itself on this entire China business. It's down 25% from the beginning of the year. What's your view on that one?
Yeah, it can be. So there is value in Tata Steel, Tata Motors, but I believe, once again, my same view, basically, why do you want to own a stock which has got majority of its earnings coming from abroad?
and especially from China, which where there are a lot of problems basically. So might as well play the domestic domestic story rather than playing anything international.
Nestle, Nischal, again, so you have a different view on that one, not the same one, not the same as Tata Motors and Sun.
See, these are all stocks where, so my view is strong about it basically, wherever there is something to do with the regulator, I think is best to be avoided. So let them come out clean basically, and then we can have a reassessment of it. Because one thing I definitely believe that the law of the land is the supreme, and you cannot play foul with the law of the land basically.
But these, don't you, I mean, for something like Nestle, don't you think it creates significant short-term opportunities as well? You know, opportunities which are only there for a small period, period in time, right? And then eventually, the strength of the franchise and the business takes over. It's back to that.
Yes, I agree basically. So, one, I have no clue basically whether the Maggi issue is only a controversy or there is something significant, because Maggi itself is a big business for Nestle. So, until as I get that clarity basically, I do not want to speculate on that.
You don't want to speculate on that. Which are your top picks in pharma, Nischal?
So, pharma space, we like Sun, we like Cipla, and then we like Dr. Reddy. That's our top three picks in the large caps basically.
And IT, in IT?
IT is very clearly Infosys is our top pick there, followed by Tech Mahindra and TCS.
Uh-huh. Okay, so you don't have any skepticism like many others have on Tech Mahindra. I mean, actually, in terms of revenue growth, Tech Mahindra is still the strongest. It has been the strongest for a while. It still is the strongest, even looking at the first quarter results, right? But people have always had issues with TechM.
Yes, but the valuations are also cheaper, much cheaper than others basically. So I think somewhere the valuation to the earnings growth, somewhere it has to come back basically. It is not that the business is broken. So there might be problem one or two quarters basically, but then the valuation is already discounting that. So then you are okay with that.
You're okay with that. Okay, fair enough. Nischal, thank you very much for joining us today. Appreciate you coming on. Good speaking with you. And thanks for your patience earlier when we lost that link.
Thanks.
Thank you. Take a quick break. Back in two. We are coming back with...